When Final Fantasy XVI was revealed in September, the initial trailer featured plenty of substance. We got to see numerous characters, a sneak peek at the game's expansive setting, and of course, numerous icons that will be central to the plot. In the aftermath, Naoki Yoshida, who is serving as the game's producer, promised that although we would have to wait until 2021 for the first real media blast, Square Enix would be launching the game's official website in October, and it would serve as a teaser for what would be to come. That website has now launched in 8 separate languages. It contains details relating to some of the prominent characters who will appear in the story, as well as the wider world in which the story takes place, and each language variant of the website offers some slight nuances. When combined with a smattering of supporting collateral, some of which has since been redacted, Square Enix has revealed a lot more information than was expected at this time about Final Fantasy XVI, and throughout this video, we're going to discuss some of this in the literal sense, but there will also be a heavy emphasis on highlighting relationships and connections within this game's specific lore, as well as the wider franchise, just as there has been within our two previous videos. The best place to start is with our main protagonist. Unnamed during the initial reveal, we now know that the main focus of our attention will be on Clive Rossfield. On the surface, this might seem like an uninspired naming choice. Clive has never been a popular name in the United States, and its peak came in 1935 when there were 41 boys born with the given name of Clive. Here in the UK, it had a modicum of popularity between the 1930s and 1960s, but it has since faded into obscurity, and although there are some popular figures, such as the actor Clive Owen, it's never been known as a powerful or commanding name, and there is limited history. But it does have meaning. And if we know anything, it's that the creative minds at Square and Square Enix have often looked to Latin languages to provide a literal context for their stories and their characters. Noctis, for example, had a very literal name, as within Latin, Noctis or Noct means night or darkness, and Aerith was named as such as a transliteration of the English word earth into katakana, used to highlight her connection with the earth. Clive has its roots in Old English and Old Norse, where it meant to split, separate, chop, or cleave. It's also cognate with the Scandinavian word cleaver, which means to climb or take a big step onto or off of something. And from what we understand, these notions will relate to Clive's story, as following a traumatic event involving Ifrit, he chooses to alter his path, separating himself from who he was to become someone else, and taking a big step towards enacting revenge for what has happened. As had been speculated following analysis of the Japanese trailer, Clive has now been confirmed as the elder brother of Joshua, and this makes him the firstborn child of the Archduke of Rosaria, the Grand Duchy from which they hail. Clive was expected to inherit Phoenix's flame and become its dominant, but when this didn't happen, he chose to dedicate his life to the sword instead. And after winning a tournament housed within the kingdom, this led to Clive becoming the first Shield of Rosaria at the tender age of just 15 years old. In this role, Clive acts as the shield to his younger brother, Joshua Rossfield, the second son of the Archduke. Joshua awoke as the dominant of Phoenix soon after birth, but laments that he was given the power instead of Clive, as he is much more passive and frail. We also learn that Joshua is 5 years younger than his elder brother. Perhaps naive to the harsh world around him, Joshua still views his kingdom's subjects with warmth and affection, and he grants his brother the power of the Phoenix as a blessing so that he can be the optimum bodyguard by enhancing his abilities and healing his wounds. At this stage, we don't know the extent of this ability, but it does seem to be similar to how Regis and Noctis were able to pass on their powers to the Kingsglaive and the Retinue via the crystal in Final Fantasy XV. The third character who was given more detail is the young girl who appeared alongside Clive and Joshua during the initial trailer. We learned that she is called Jill Warwick, but unlike Clive and Joshua, she is part of the Rosarian nobility for political reasons. Born a princess, Jill was used to help broker peace between Rosaria and the now fallen Northern Territories, and this saw her become a ward of Rosaria. But despite not being a blood relative, Jill was raised by the Archduke as if she were his daughter, and she has forged a close relationship with the Archduke's two sons. Although the similarities aren't explicit, this is a comparable situation to the one that Teetra found herself in during Final Fantasy Tactics. She was not the daughter of Barbaneth Beold, but he raised her alongside Alma nonetheless when he needn't have done so. In terms of the name Jill, well, this has ties back to the Latin name Juliana, and in the context of famous medieval figures, there were numerous Julianas who were religious martyrs. These two elements suggest that Jill could be used as a plot device, much as Teetra was in Tactics. In addition to these character details, we also learnt about five of the nations that will have prominence within the wider world known as Valisthea. This has an odd syllabic similarity to the word Ivalice, and we know that it consists of two halves known as Storm and Ash, with there also being two overarching factions present known as the Crystalline Dominion and the Crystalline Orthodox. The main nation that we've seen so far is the Grand Duchy of Rosaria, a member of the Crystalline Dominion, and this has similarities with Rosaria from Final Fantasy XII, as despite having a slight difference of spelling in English, in Japanese they have the exact same spelling. We learn that this kingdom has a strong association with Phoenix, and the dominant of Phoenix is enthroned as Archduke when they come of age. This might suggest that Joshua's father was once the dominant of Phoenix, and the power was passed on when it awoke within Joshua. Rosaria draws its energy, known as Aether, from the mother crystal called Drake's Breath. This resides on a volcanic island off the coast of the main continent, but they aren't the only nation that is connected with Drake's Breath, as despite drawing from it, Rosaria doesn't control the crystal, and it instead falls under the dominion of the Iron Kingdom. This is a collection of small islands off the coast of Storm, and in addition to speaking their own language, they are aligned with the Crystalline Orthodox, an extreme faith that worships the crystals and deems dominance as unholy abominations that must be executed. Based on this, we can infer that the group we saw at the beginning of the trailer might be associated with the Iron Kingdom as they are looking to hunt down dominance. Clive also appears to be part of this group, and due to the close proximity of the two kingdoms, this does feel logical. Aside from Rosaria and the Iron Kingdom, two other nations that reside on Storm were revealed. The Holy Empire of Sandbreak is described as the largest theocratic force in the region, and they worship an unknown deity. The Empire is overseen by a Holy Emperor, who is seen as the living incarnation of said unknown deity, and they have an unknown dominant, who serves as the Empire's champion, taking the battlefield when they need to turn the tide in their favour. They draw their power from Drake's Head, a mother crystal which their capital city, named Oriflame, is built around. And we can, based on the description and the map location, assume that this venerable piece of concept art relates to the Sandbreak capital city, not least because of the subtle wyvern down in the corner. In Japanese, Sandbreak is denoted as Zambalek, and based on this, we know from the initial Japanese trailer where the Dragoon was associated with Zambalek that despite both being part of the Crystalline Dominion, they are antagonizing Rosaria. And this highlights that despite there being peace, there are tensions brewing under the surface. The other nation residing on Storm is the Dalmachian Republic. It is said that this is made up of five smaller states that have a central government, with the dominant of Titan serving as a special advisor to said government. They draw their power from Drake's Fang, a mother crystal that is half hidden in the heart of a mountain range, and from the map, this positions the Dalmachian Republic as a southern state. By looking at the flag, it appears that each of the individual states may have an affinity with the elements. We can't say for certain, but it looks like there are depictions of fire, wind, lightning, earth, and perhaps dark, but one of them could easily be water or ice. Based on the helm that features in the middle of the flag and the small icon for one of the cities, there's also a Mongol and Persian vibe. This suggests, along with the appearance of Titan, that they are one of the nations who we saw doing battle at the start of the initial trailer as they're using scimitars. The remaining nation, known as the Kingdom of Waled, is said to claim the entirety of Ash, the eastern half of Valisthea, and they gain their power from the mother crystal known as Drake's Spine. Even though they are the sole kingdom in the region, they are not without opposition. Their dominance is often contested by orcs and other beastmen who make their home on Ash, but thanks to the efforts of their unknown dominant, they are able to keep their borders intact and are even building a new army with the purpose of expansion. The Crystalline Dominion then sits at the heart of Valisthea, and it's built around Drake's Tail, the tallest of the Mother Crystals. Its placement means it holds a lot of strategic importance, and it has often been the focus of heated conflicts. But in recent times, four major nations agreed to an armistice, with the new council being formed where each nation has equal representation, free from the influence of any specific dominant. Outside of these details, what's clear from the world map is that there is a lot left undisclosed. You can see that there are lots of light regions with numerous smaller settlements dotted around, and there are dark regions where nothing is present other than topography. We know though that there are settlements or ruins within these dark regions, as the northern territories no doubt reside within this dark region to the west of Sandbreak, and there are many beastmen and orc settlements throughout Ash. What's also interesting is the disclosure and non-disclosure of Eikons. We've seen four in action so far and have been able to speculate as to the appearance of a fifth in Garuda, but only two have been given a home, Phoenix associated with Rosaria and Titan associated with Dalmechia. Thanks to a now-removed tweet from the official Final Fantasy XVI Twitter account, we know that there will be at least 9 separate Eikons appearing within the final product, and this has led to plenty of speculation. Initial thoughts placed Shiva with Sandbreg due to its blue banner and feminine figure, and there being 4 major Eikons with the exclusion of Ifrit and 4 nations. But now knowing that there are many more Eikons present, that relationship between Eikons and nations doesn't seem so clear-cut. Shiva, for example, could have easily been associated with the fallen northern territories, which would still point to Jill as a possible dominant. Sandbreg also has a clear association with Holy. To date, there have only been 5 summons within the franchise associated with that element, and the most regular have been Alexander and Carbuncle. We also know from the initial trailer that dragoons hail from Sandbreg. This is supported by wyverns featuring within the flag, one being present in the concept art, and the worship of an unknown deity. This opens up the possibility of Bahamut, but that wouldn't explain why the Dragoon's attacks caused a surge of lightning, something that could also point to Ramu. The Kingdom of Waled feels a bit more clear-cut though. We don't know much about the divulged lore, but the flag does feature a horse with 6 legs and a spear. This points to the appearance of Odin, as Sleipnir, Odin's horse, has often been depicted within the Final Fantasy franchise as a 6-legged horse. Odin also has a strong association with Gungnir. This would then account for 6 of the known Eikons, 7 if we're assuming Garuda fits in somewhere as another nomadic Eikon like Shiva, but then that leads to another distinction. Ifrit is classified as a dark Eikon as opposed to just being an Eikon, and this opens up the possibility for some Mother Crystals housing 2 tiers of Eikon, one of which has a more sinister undertone. If we look through the annals of history, then there are some clear possibilities here. It leaves room for the likes of Ramu and Bahamut, Alexander and Carbuncle, and even Leviathan to appear, and none of them will be out of place given their prominence over the years. Hopefully, next year, many of these questions should be answered, and we will start to learn more about the wider cast of characters and the intricacies that tie these nations together. And I don't know about you guys, but we cannot wait. That's all we've got for now though. Be sure to let us know in the comments your thoughts about all these new details, as well as your theories. And if you enjoyed this breakdown, then please do hit that like button and subscribe to our channel. For now though, this is Daryl signing out. A big thanks to all of our Patreon and YouTube membership supporters, and of course, a big thanks to all of you for watching this video. I hope to see you all again soon for more Final Fantasy goodness.